It is November the 30th, 2024. I'm Chris, and this is The Future of Photography.
The Future of Photography.
Hello, gentlemen. Adrian and Jeremiah, how are you doing?
We're good. I speak for Adrian.
I'll get my coat then. Yeah, all good. Thank you. Yes.
All good.
All good. Looking forward to the conversation today.
Are you getting any like pre-holiday rush kind of stuff? Busyness?
Lots of shopping to do, of course, given that
that's what I mean,
we're recording, recording this the day after Black Friday, so
How does that look in the UK? Is that where you go to the shops, or is it more of an online shopping thing? Or?
It looks kind of like red, white, and bluey with some stars and some stripes. it's one of those kind of things that we've imported, like the orange and black one at the end of October as well. They're not really British things. We don't like them very much, but we do love a bargain in this country. So
We're so Americanized over here.
Well, evidently the Americans are coming for the Cotswolds. That's what I hear.
Well, they'll have to fight Jeremy Clarkson for that then, won't they? Madonna and the fella from Blur, and Alan.
Robert Llewellyn as well.
Yes, okay. Him too, yes.
Here we come.
Sounds like the Cotswolds are already full, actually. So maybe
probably. Keep out, like a good British club. We're in. Thank you.
I think Madonna's American. I'm not sure. She's been here a long time.
All right. Let's kick this off. We have things to talk about. Quick, short newsreel. Short. The emphasis is on short.
Okay, boss. Okay.
And then Jeremiah gave us a topic that I think is really important, really good. A choice of hardware, software, or service for each of us that holds promise for our own image making. See what that'll bring us. And then picks. So, newsreel. Let's kick this off with a newsreel. We have film news. Again, film boom is still going strong. We have a new film camera out there by a company named Film Never Die. $230 camera named Nana. And it's a point and shoot, which... Yeah, why not? It's inspired by a Contax. Yes, it is, and it's made from metal. From a technical point of view, it's not very sophisticated. It has a single element lens in it. It has a built-in flash, and you point and shoot. It's a point and shoot, but it's a new film camera, which I find intriguing.
I think it looks cool, and that's the important thing.
Yeah, well, for some people, sure. I mean, I haven't seen pictures out of it, but I don't think that's the important part about it. It's, I think it shows that that film is still around, and film is not gonna go anywhere anytime soon. Same with Kodak. We talked about this last week. I think Kodak closing down their production in Rochester for a few weeks to make upgrades, so they're investing in film. So film not dead. I think that's pretty cool.
I like it. If somebody sells some stickers that say contacts on them, and then you save yourself a good £1,800. I was just cruising secondhand camera websites as I do. I saw a Contax T3 for £2,000.
Really?
2000, and I think that was a reputable place as well. I can't remember which one, but it was a reputable second-hand dealer. £2,000 for a Contax T3. So and some stickers, and you're saving 85%, right?
Yeah, I mean, I'm thrilled. I have my original on my shelf, which I still use, and I had no idea the value of that. I was going through some storage, and I found a little lighter, which belonged to my father, and I kind of polished it up. Was silver polish, it was completely black, and it was a ST DuPont. And I don't know much about lighters, but upon researching, There's a lighter that sells for like $1,200, $1,500 nowadays. Wow, see, cool. I have no idea about these, like, you know, these things.
Yeah, I got a golden watch, like a golden pocket watch. Uh-huh. As a
from someone, from some relative
years and years ago,
no doubt.
Sort of. And I was doing some investigation if that thing is worth anything. 150 euros. So didn't work
out. When you're good for when you're cosplaying as a train conductor, I think.
Yes, it is, with a vest and stuff and a monocle.
Absolutely.
But
yeah.
Speaking of things, old things that make more money, William Eggleston print sold for $1.44 million at an auction, which is
bargain.
Mind blowing, especially as Eggleston is still alive. So this is I find this cool. I mean, titled untitled. It's not titled. It's from somewhere between 71, 74. It's mounted on a board, and it's a rather recent print. So it's not even a color print from a negative. It's a pigment print, which means a pigment print is a inkjet print with, like, very expensive ink, probably, but seems that the way this is made is not as important anymore as it used to be.
It's a very famous photograph, right?
It is.
So, you know, if anybody has seen any of Eggleston's work, you'll know the photograph of, you know,
of the glass of cocktail by an airplane window.
Yeah. So, Interesting that it could sell for that much, not be, yeah, because one of the things that made him, or that he was famous for, maybe not made him famous, but he was famous for in the early days, was the way that he went about printing, and he used new color printing technologies of the day, didn't he, to get a very vibrant color print.
Cibachrome he used, I believe.
I think he's still credited as the, some call him the father of color photography. He brought color photography in. Or he brought art to the color photography at a time when photographers were mostly stuck up about black and white being the only artistic photography.
That's potentially a very contentious thing to say. And I know we're avoiding rabbit holes, so I'll say this and then we'll all look the other way and move away from the rabbit hole. But was it him? Or was it the fella at MoMA who curated the exhibition? And I can't remember his name off the top of my head.
John. All right, we'll move on to the next one, which is still analog related, and it's Leica, a one-of-a-kind Leica camera that sold for $3.8 million at an auction. And
damn, I knew I shouldn't have sold that.
So the interesting thing is, well, this is literally a one-of-a-kind. It was a prototype made specially for the German army. And so that's why it has this olive kind of paint on it. And they apparently didn't need it. So someone put it in a box and it stayed there forever. It's pristine. It's new. It's like new.
Okay.
And the other interesting part is that this camera was on auction in China. They had an auction in Shanghai, not in, this is Ostlicht, which is a very, like, well-known auction house in Vienna. There's also Westlicht, which is another auction house also in Vienna that do a lot of Leica. But the one that sold that, they apparently are more eastbound. And they had a lot of interesting things in that auction, like old M3 Chrome from 53 that sold for nearly €1 million. Black paint Leica, an old MP, which is quite worn down, but that didn't devalue it too much, I guess. A gun type of telephoto Leica, and some other stuff. So, yeah, Leica's selling well. Isn't that cool? So,
yeah.
if you go up to your attic and have a look, maybe you'll find some old cameras that might be worth something. Last piece of news. It's interesting. There's a piece of technology that has, in the last years, three, four, 5 years, become almost ubiquitous with content creators, and that is Bluetooth or Wi-Fi enabled microphones, right? People who stand in front of a camera know that the further away you are from the microphone, the worse it sounds. So you want to have a microphone at your lapel or somewhere that you talk into. And you've all seen these boxes, these little Rode microphone boxes, Rode Mic Go, I think it's called, or Go Mic.
I've got one boxes. Of them. Wireless, Rode Wireless, something or other. Yeah, yeah, definitely got. Yep.
And then they have a little fuzzy thing on it against the wind, and you put them there, and they're very visible. And there's other manufacturers. DJI has one now. There's a Chinese manufacturer, Holy Land, who makes some interesting ones too. And now another manufacturer has entered the field who doesn't come from microphones. They come from tripods. Three-legged thing, a British tripod maker, is now offering one of these microphone kits that is that's a charging box that contains two transmitters and one receiver. Pretty standard configuration for these things, and you plug in the receiver in your camera or your phone, and the transmitters go on the people that talk, and then you get some.
I would imagine that's pretty good. A three-legged thing is very well made. I have an old.
But interesting is the tripods they make are pure hardware. There's nothing digital, nothing electronic about them. So them getting into this whole electronics area, that really surprised me.
Yeah, yeah, me too. Actually, it's the rise
of the influencers.
It is. I'm pretty sure it is. It's something about that.
People standing in front of their, you know, three-legged thing tripod with their camera of choice and talking to it.
It's also one of the cheaper options. So they have a pretty good shot at getting this thing into people's hands.
So DJI has been really pushing on all cylinders in a lot of different directions. In fact, I just bought something on Black Friday, being in California. We're always kind of, the sky is falling here. I bought a power, you know, what we used to have, fill up a Honda generator. Mm-hmm. And now DJI has made a 1,000 kilowatt charger that's quite small.
1,000 watts, not kilowatts.
1,000 watt.
That would be crazy.
1,000 watt. But it, you know, with all kinds of manipulation and control and parsing and everything for $400. On special, it was 50% off, I think, from DJI as part of their Black Friday, and it's probably available for you guys too. But amazing, just an amazing deal, I thought, for something like that, as powerful as it is. So I will survive.
There's loads of good stuff going on. I think on the three-legged thing, I wonder if they'll get into, like, you know, electronics embedded in tripod legs, because that would be quite cool. Have you seen that
Kickstarter thing about the digital tripod? Have you seen that?
No, but imagine if you could have like a whole YouTube studio or streaming setup, like in the tripods, and like one leg was full of batteries, another leg was full of processing gear, the third leg was some advanced Starlink antenna of some sort, right? And you just stick your camera on the tripod, and you can broadcast from anywhere in the world, because the world needs more.
All right, we'll have to extend the news segment just for one more thing, and that's Benro. Benro it's a tripod manufacturer. They've been around for a while. They started off by entering the market on the very cheap segment, but their stuff is pretty good, and now they are like kind of one of the players that are known. And they had a Kickstarter 2.5-3 years ago about a self-leveling tripod. So you have a tripod, it has motors in the legs, it has some electronics, you put it on the ground and it goes bzz, 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 and it levels, which is what you want. The thing is this thing should have been delivered 2 years ago. They now have delivered, out of the 4,000 or 5,000 that have been backed, they've delivered 400 or 500 or something, and the videos that come in, just it doesn't look good. It's not good. It falls apart. It's loud. Then. It's weird. It's so people are not happy about it.
I'm going to suggest a different. I'm going to
can't imagine that anybody at Benro is a sailor. Sorry, Jeremiah. Can't imagine that anybody at Benro is a sailor, right? Because anybody that's been on a boat knows that the compass floats in oil, right? And lo and behold, it's self-leveling.
Yeah, so, but try that with a tripod. No, it's not working.
But I think there is such a thing, and it would be called a drone. And if they could make a silent drone with electronics to your speaker, you just have to float it out there in space, and put it in your pocket, and record to it.
Okay, stop. No more rabbit holes. Okay. Jeremiah, why don't you introduce us to the topic of today?
Well, I thought I would, in light of just thinking about what current technologies, whether it's software, hardware, or service, could have major impact going forward as the company develops more sophisticated versions of what it has. And my choice today is for a company called Topaz, which I'm sure we've talked about before, but is specifically Gigapixel, which is a software that is designed here it is on screen, larger, sharper, more real. So, an image that is, 700K, 450K, processed through that can give you a, medium format style photograph, very sharp, apparently, because it actually studies the pixels and it uses AI to kind of double, triple, manufacture and assess the relative the relative spaces between them and how they could join, and create something quite special. Now, right now, it's good because it makes what we would consider a pixelated or blurred image visible. Good. Okay. Looks okay. Looks good. But imagine being able to take a little pocket cam or, something shot on your iPhone and have an equivalent of a plate camera, a 8x10 style image that is absolutely pin sharp and capable of doing a massive blow up. And because of, again, printing technology that enables us to print negatives now pretty effectively and contact print them, whether it's platinum alternative processes or traditional, into amazing quality imagery that is indistinguishable from a plate camera. Now, I'm not talking about the process because we did and have discussed the slow process of taking these pictures as being part of the aesthetic and kind of creative meditation of photography. So I'm not really talking about that. But I am talking about using a kind of street photography sensibility or just snapping a beautiful naturalistic image on a walk that can be blown up significantly. And of course, we know how we can adjust bokeh and we can adjust color and all the rest of it. But I think that as Topaz develops into something more and more sophisticated on a professional level, the potential for using AI within these things can create a whole new aesthetic of photography that is very exciting.
That could be really cool. Do you remember a couple of years back we were looking at a prototype technology that would change the perspective in a shot for a different focal length, to make the things in the background bigger or smaller and stuff like that? If they could build that sort of technology in, and you said, right, okay, I've shot this on my phone, but I'd like it to look like a Hasselblad 80mm, please, on a 6x6, and model the fall off of that individual lens and change the perspective and the compression in the image so that it, that could be awesome, couldn't it?
Well, I think we're close to that.
Yeah, so this is pretty much the continuation of the promise of that computational photography gave us early on, where you had, was it a Sony RX100 or something, where you had a camera that had a a lens that was not making straight lines, but then the camera built-in correction would straighten them, and even on your Lightroom or other pieces of software, that would already be kind of baked in. So you'd have the camera correcting things, and of course that has two promises. The first one is for you to be able to squeeze more out of what the equipment can give you, and the other one is that the manufacturer can save money by putting a cheaper lens in there that is not as corrected.
Yeah, right? I would say.
And that is the continuation, because you have a camera that doesn't have the resolution, and now you can fake the resolution. It's not even fake. It's actual resolution, but it's not necessarily 100% what was there, but it's close enough so you don't care.
Well, remember, resolution is just, you know, how the lens and capture kind of intake off objects. So.
And that's it is enhancing the quality. But of course, those of us who know that the real picture taken at that resolution with according equipment feels more valuable to us.
Yeah, because we're purists. But in that way, I would say I can imagine a software like Topaz being just integrated, as you've been saying, into a camera. So that you can set, your JPEG to be small quality, you know, like just for posting, or large. You can have a maximum quality that is really significant if you have the right memory.
Would you expect those pictures then also to be marked by content credentials? As in, this picture has been AI enhanced?
I don't, because I don't see the point of it.
Mm.
I mean, I honestly don't see the point of labeling some process, because even pictures taken on film, I mean, do we have to say that the colors here were, you know, represented by a certain chemical process and plastic?
Big rabbit hole alert, I know.
It's well, isn't it the image that is the final arbiter of our reactions, not the process? I will argue that.
So I've got a use case for that, but we'll wait until it's my turn, because part of what my choice is, it involves an answer to your question about what's that good for. So bear with me a minute, and we'll come back to it.
Okay, you'll be going last here, so I will squeeze mine in right now. And mine is also AI related, but also teaching related. So it's not necessarily about the photo making, the image making process, but more the teaching others to become good image makers process. And the longer I look at photography, the more I figure out that it's not necessarily the tech side of photography that is the challenge. We see this. Cameras are so good. Smartphones are good. Bigger cameras are getting better. We have the tools. That is relatively easy to teach. But of course, what we see is a lot of, especially today, a lot of lack of attention and mindfulness in people. So you need to understand that there is a photo to take. And that means you have to be attentive. You have to notice, right? And with all the distractions we have these days, it's really tough to get people to notice. That's one of the challenges. Another one is fear of failure and fear of our inner criticism. There's an inner critic sitting in our mind, and it's very sarcastic. It's more of the schoolyard bully, right? It says, "Oh, this is not a good photo. Don't press that shutter button. It's not necessary. Or delete that photo. It's no good." And that's something that holds us back. Holds many people back. Creative people are all haunted by that. And then another thing we have is overwhelming choice. As in, if you get all the choice in the world, you won't be able to pick without feeling that you have missed maybe a better choice. So that is a challenge. And another one is a bit... that comes out of that, a bit of an inability to tell stories. The storytelling is really important, but with all the focus on tech and the lack of attention and so on. So these are challenges that I think are really crucial if you have the tech down and you still want to up that photography of yours, and these are areas to attack. Now, Go ahead.
I so think that you've touched on something significant, and that is greater than just the photographic process.
Yes.
I mean, I've taught classes on directing to graduate students. And, you know, they'll come in and the first thing they want to know is like, oh, this camera and this lens. And they want all the tech and all the kind of rules of filmmaking. And I basically say I can teach you everything you need to know about the actual technique of filmmaking in a day. I mean, if that. I mean, just what the line is, how to cross it, how to break rules, how to, you know, succumb to them, all of the rest of it. But, you know, they go, where do you put the camera? How do you know? Blah, blah, blah. I said, well, you got to put the, and this is not me making this up, this is a very common phrase, but you put the camera where the story is. Same thing in photography. Yeah. But understanding where the story is something that is cultural and personal and has to do with life choices and reading and being involved in life, nothing to do with the technology of creativity. You have to have a story to tell or to recognize.
Right.
And most of the students didn't have the time for it. They just wanted to Google it. They wanted to be on it. They just wanted to drive towards influences. They wanted to be famous. And they didn't want to, for example, read a novel by Gorky to understand the personal in Russia at a certain time, which enables, et cetera.
And that's where I think I need to attack this. Of course, being prescriptive and telling people you must do this and this and this is not going to yield anything, because you only get resistance. But I was thinking that one solution could be to develop teaching tools, and I'm talking software. I'm talking software that runs on the device that people have in their pocket, and everyone has that in the pocket. And there are little exercises to help you, very low friction, to increase your attentiveness, your mindfulness. There are exercises to help you take a bit, maybe shut up that inner critic a little bit. There are exercises to help you understand the choice thing and and limit that, and so on. And there are tools to help you become a better storyteller. Now, of course, I'm not a software developer, and I can't afford to hire someone to do that. But I have a whole bunch of AIs in my pocket, and so I've been working. I can't show anything right now, but it's all very promising. I've been working with a couple of AIs to, first of all, develop these ideas, develop these tools, and. I'm now in the middle of programming a couple of them and testing them out early spring. So it's coming along nicely, and AI is a good partner to work on that. And
sounds intriguing.
It is. So yeah, I'm not sure it will be a product of any sort at this point. I'm planning to use it on workshops to help people kind of intuitively and every day a little bit more understand what these challenges are, because most people don't understand the challenges, and just standing there and telling them is not going to help. You have to show them.
Also telling people to not be afraid of failure, but actually run towards failure.
Part of it, yeah. It's part of it.
And that will overcome the fear of failure, but also you'll be able to recognize things that you would never have imagined before.
The tech world calls it failing forward.
Yeah, failing upward, yeah.
So that's what I'm working on. So AI is a really essential tool for me to... because I had these ideas for a long time, but AI was very helpful in helping me structure these ideas and talking through them and looking at what makes sense and what doesn't make sense, and then testing it with a human and look at what they have to say about it, and then bring it back into the AI area and say, okay, now let's brainstorm a couple of ideas of how to make this a part of everyone's like back pocket. Yeah. So I'll report on that.
Yeah, interesting stuff. Hey, if you need any testers, you got two right here.
At this point, it's in German, so
no problem.
Yeah, but it should be very easy to just translate it.
I'll get my AI to translate AI to your translate AI. Your AI. Fine. Yeah, yeah. Yes. No, language is no problem these days. It's all good.
All right. So that was AI twice, right? We have Topaz,
Nuts,
Upstater. So, Adrian, what have you brought us?
Oh, well, we're going to go for a full house, I'm afraid. But I have come at this very much from the application, as you guys have, actually. So the application of technology, and mine is a software one as well. And it's inspired by two things, both of which are from my professional life. One of which is genuinely from my professional life. And the other one is about something I see at lunchtimes in my professional life. So we'll go with that one first. There's a client office I visit fairly regularly at the moment, and they've just had in their office, they've just had their canteen refurbished, and the new tills they've got to check out with your lunch have image recognition devices. Uh-huh. And you put your tray down under what looks like, you know, a small enlarger, right? It's got a camera on instead of a head, and it looks at your lunch, and it tells you what it is that you're buying. Now, the first couple of weeks of this, they opened, they were in training mode, so they had more floor walkers, and they were making corrections, and it still does get things wrong, but it's quite astounding. You can put a plate of food and a can of drink and stuff like that, you know, on a tray, and it will actually, you know, recognize what you're buying. I thought that's a fantastic use of image recognition technology, so a real world use.
I remember there was a food court back when I was maybe 16 or 17, and they had like items, and they would weigh what you put on the plate, and then of course you would take an expensive item and hide it under like a layer of cucumbers or something to not have to pay for it, which we became really good at hiding things. So could you do the same thing here, right?
Could do, perhaps. Yeah, maybe yes. But
stuck your face under that?
Priceless.
Then yeah. Police comes over because you have a cannibal thing going on against you.
So there's that as one of my inspirations. The other thing is that you both may know that it's quite hard for a large corporation, a large enterprise, to adopt large language models, because it's of the shift from deterministic software to probabilistic software, right? So, you know, it is very hard to then justify why you made such and such a decision, or to automate processes when the outcome of these models is probabilistic. One of the things that is very popular at the moment with corporations testing LLMs is the ability to converse with your repository of documents. So think... a ChatGPT type experience, you know, where you're having a conversation, but you're having a conversation with a body of documents. And then, of course, you can ring fence those on your corporate network. You can deploy an LLM on your network, and everything is secure, and it's not going out to the web to give away your corporate secrets and stuff like that. So these two things coming together, image recognition, conversing with collections of stuff. The thing I want to do is I want to have a conversation with my image library. I want to be able to, you know, the image, clearly the images need to be automatically catalogued and categorised and, you know, and recognised by the algorithms as well, so they can pull back, what it is that you're asking for. So that's where the image recognition comes in. But I'd like to be able to actually provide a written prompt to have a conversation with my image library, or maybe even a visual prompt, you know, like a Google reverse image search. We can say, you know, here's one I took today. Give me six that look like this from the library, please, or something like that. And I think, you know, imagine if you had, possibly a nice one for this time of year is you wanted to produce a calendar for your family for next year that was all the exciting things that your family did this year. Imagine just writing a brief and say, okay, give me two pictures from the summer holiday to France. Give me, you know, New York in the wintertime. Give me or whatever, you know, the things that you've done. You know, a couple of the dog please running around. And you just write all of that as a written brief, and suddenly all the images come back to you. I'd love to be able to, you know, interrogate converse with, you know, just manipulate my images that way.
So this is for finding images mainly at this point.
It is, but there's the this and that, but stepping forward, this is the my answer to Jeremiah's so what question from earlier on, is that I'd love the image history to travel with each of those images, right? So you would get your normal metadata, you get the location, the time, the date, etc., etc. But if you've done some processing for it, you know, it should bring that. It should bring the EDL essentially, right? The metadata for what edits you've made, and it should do that across whatever workflow you have, because we're all using different workflows now, and often we use multiple applications, you know, and you have to impex it all. You have to save it out from one application, import it to the next application, etc., etc. What if all of that was just a non-destructive EDL that went with it that you could then reconstruct in the future? And you could interrogate that as well. With your AI, you could say, okay, what exactly is the workflow that this image has been through? Because I quite like the look. How did I achieve that look? It was 2 years ago. I can't remember for the life of me.
Boy, are you talking my language? This would be mana from heaven.
So the search part, isn't that what Apple Intelligence is promising to do very soon? That you can ask. Maybe. That you can ask Siri to, like, show me the best pictures of the vacation I did with my parents 3 years ago in such and such. And
it'd be great if it can.
That's the promise. Of course, we haven't seen anything there as
now. I think it would be like, you know, in my case, it would be like, give me a dozen images from Patagonia landscapes that are slightly out of focus, or that, you know what I mean, that I shot in black and white with wide lenses. Boom. That's what I want. You know, just last week I was looking for two negatives.
Hardware.
That I had not digitized, that were shot way back in the Vogue days, and climbing up and pulling down negatives and going through. I never found them. I know they're there, but never found them. And should I have had a robust search engine that would really have motivated me to digitize all of my old negatives, which I just do selectively, to be able to pull stuff out of your memory effectively, going, oh yeah, what did I do that summer? Whether it's subject or something similar. In other words, I've done this picture, but I really like the kind of overall tone. What other images have I done in this palette? Things like that. I don't think Apple is up to that yet. I think, I mean, you know, we not do yet, a search on our phone, we go dog, and you'll get the 8,000 dog pictures that take up most of your iPhone pictures. But speaking personally,
speak for yourself.
And Adrian's so, catching up,
I'm on my way. Yeah, I'm on my way to that. Definitely, I took a great one today. Actually, I need the topaz thing today because I was out walking Jasmine, my dog, today, and I had a 50mm equivalent lens on the camera, and she, I got a great panning shot of her running, and got her with all 4 feet off the ground, and she was quite clear. And because I was panning, the background was a little blurred, and so it was great. But I shot that on a 10 megapixel camera, and she was really small in the frame because she was away, and perfect. I was on a prime lens. So I just need, that, enhance that up, great.
I've seen just recently a new like AI doing extending photos, so you can have like the 50mm. I wanted this to be much more wide angle, and
Photoshop will do that.
It just paints it in, but in video as well. So yeah, we're looking at that stuff to become true. So Jeremiah, you want your photos to be tiny but still massively. Resolved.
I want to choose the resolution from the output that I need. I mean, it's very, very simple. I don't always want large images, but, you know, I'll bring them in at 72. I'll put them on a website, blah, blah, blah. Then I'll go to print it. I'll need 300. I've been experimenting printing at 600 dpi with my new printer. Anyway, but all of those the adjustments of the output is, you know, or if I'm doing a book. It would be great to go, here's the image in RGB, give me an output in CMYK for print without having to do a conversion.
So you want resolution. I want to develop teaching tools, and Adrian wants to talk to his photo library.
That's cool. Right. Yeah.
So I don't think we're far away from any of these. No. To be honest, I think this is all within
the near future. The near future of photography.
All right, and with that, let's go to the picks of the week. I think we're gonna start with. Do we start with? We start with sound. How about that? What is Richer Sounds?
So, Richer Sounds is an audio visual retailer here in the UK. So that's the name of the stores. My pick of the week this week is more of a plea for assistance, and those who are on the Discord will already have seen this plea for assistance. I really need a small pair of powered Bluetooth speakers that can sit in a particular place in my house. I found really difficult to get. Just a pair of speakers that you plug in, they're sort of desktop or slightly larger size. They're actually going to sit on a windowsill. So this is not about ultimate hi-fi quality. This is about just getting a good sound in a way that's easy to use, in a pair of speakers that are always paired because they're connected together, not because you've got to go through an app on your phone and go through some sort of weird Bluetooth pairing mechanism to get a stereo.
So you're not looking at AirPods, at HomePods or something?
No, I'm not looking at that sort of thing. I just want a pair of speakers, but that I can just stream from my phone to. They don't have to be, they're not massively hi-fi quality, because mostly I will stream Spotify to them, right? So, you know, this is not to be a hi-fi. It's just to be a really accessible set of speakers. And there's so many Bluetooth speakers around, and they're all great, but they're all, you know, they're all stereo, but they're all only, you know, a foot across, and you don't get a stereo field out of that. And then you've got the ones that you can say, oh, you buy two of these and you can pair them up. But like I said, you have to do that with an app. I had some Bose ones in the past, and half the time the pairing fails. And by the time you've actually got them working, you've lost the will to live, let alone to listen to music. So, yeah, I just want a pair of speakers I can Bluetooth stream to that are reasonably compact, sound reasonable. And these ones here look like great candidates. I have no idea what they sound like. This was part of my Black Friday shopping, window shopping on Black Friday.
So, without knowing a solution for you, but the first thing my mind goes to, because people are raving about it, is Sonos.
Yeah, I'm aware of the brand, and I know people.
It's also not cheap.
And speak very highly of them. As long as it's not ludicrously expensive, that's okay. They will get a fair amount of use, but it's I don't know. But again, are they always on? Are they always paired? I don't know. I'd have to look into that. But yeah,
We have a pair that look similar that were a gift from a music producer. They're inexpensive, but they're studio monitors. They're about yay big. They are everything that you discussed. And the brand escapes me, but if you email me, I'll dig them up. We use them exactly the same.
Studio monitors might work. I mean, sometimes they're a bit clinical, aren't they? By design, for obvious reasons.
No, these look not, they're all black, but they look very similar to your photo. But the sound quality is astonishing for the price, and we use it exactly. I mean, my wife uses it more in the kitchen. I mean, just. And the sound is booming and beautiful and clear. And
that's good. Hey, I'll take all that. This is why it's my pick of the week. I will take all the help I can get, because I'm really struggling.
Me coming from audio studio monitor sounds perfect. So, Jeremiah, you brought us
something old school, sort of.
Something old school. Lens Baby Composer Pro 2.
No AI need apply. This is another one of Lens Baby's curious lens design that allows distortion in a twist.
Sorry for that.
It doesn't come with music, but it is.
The website comes with music.
That's it. It looks fun. It looks, I've been on a filter crazy. You know, I just love the ability of shifting the background in hardware.
Also, that's another one of these things that takes away the choices later on, because you are going to bake that onto film or onto the sensor with and that takes away choice later, and that makes
you happy. Maybe the AI could probably straighten it out and make it all flat. But,
of course,
who wants to do that? Anyway, you know, for those who are interested in Lens Baby's line of kind of fun lenses, they're not like the best quality, but they are getting better every year. I'd say that this is an interesting kind of pairing and something that looks pretty creative. You know, could revitalize the way of seeing, which is always, we've talked about this, you get a little bit of new gear and all of a sudden you walk in the world seeing everything through that, the way a surgeon looks at a body holding a scalpel.
All right, I do have a pick myself, and it's a video that... Okay, I have to prefix this. I follow this space nerd on YouTube. Many will know him. His name is Scott Manley. He reports on what's going on in space, and it's usually quite deep into the weeds. And he's also, he studied astronomy. So he talks about telescopes and where telescopes have or how far they have come. And we're not talking about the telescopes that astronomers use with like huge mirrors and stuff. No, we talk about those for everyday people. Has any of you had a telescope as a kid?
Mm-hmm. Not a proper one.
But
semi-proper.
You had to like find the North Star and align it. And if you wanted to take a photo that's longer than 10 seconds, you'd have to have a motor that moves it with the Earth's rotation or against the Earth's rotation. And you had to have an adapter to put your camera on there. Now, of course, we have seen telescopes that have a camera built in, which is already cool. We have seen telescopes that have, let's say, starfinders in there. So you can put like type in Alpha Centauri and it'll find it in the sky for you. That stuff has been around for a while, but over the last years, these telescopes have, or some telescopes, and definitely not the cheaper ones, we're talking a few thousand bucks here, but telescopes have now come to the point where they have smartphone-like features built in. We are talking about telescopes that don't only find what you want to shoot in the sky, but they will also do all the processing for you in telescope, as in they will layer pictures, they will align them, they will make so and so many exposures and bake them into one picture and give you color and give you all the details you want and so on. Now, this is not, again, not the kind of telescope that you would... that you would spend 10,000 bucks on and plus a camera for 3,000 and an adapter and stuff and then spend 5 hours of processing. These are lower resolution in the final image, but you get something out of there that looks like the pictures that you see on a NASA website, for example. So it's
cool.
He got that on loan, so it's a bit of an ad, of course, but it is fascinating to see what you can get with these things and what they're capable of for everyday people. We're talking about not the astronomy nerd, of course. We're talking about someone who wants to do that but doesn't have either the patience or the capacity to spend months learning that stuff and learning special software and so on. It's a bit like the smartphone. If you have a smartphone nowadays, you take pictures of the northern lights with it or of the night sky. You couldn't do this 5 years ago. So the technology has so much advanced. There's so much processing and computation in a phone that will give everyone who's not into photography the ability to do these kind of things. And this has happened in parallel in telescopes. And it's fascinating. It's really fascinating.
I have a question.
Sure, go ahead.
Too. I'm quite impressive. He took all those pictures from inside that room. But
he took it from up on his roof while being in the house in the warm and remote controlling this from his phone.
Pretty impressive. I wonder how this works if you use it as a long lens.
I don't know.
I was. I have no idea
if
well.
If it does that. Maybe it has a privacy protection mode or something.
I think that would be. I'm always interested in the use of high power telescope as, you know, long lenses, because usually the images that come out of them are pretty effective. Pretty
anyway, amazing. I'm not an astronomer. I'm not an astrophotographer per se. But
you play one on TV.
Sometimes I do. This was a bit of an eye opener. I found it really, really intriguing. So technology is moving forward there as well. All right. I think that brings us to the end.
It does.
We are The Future of Photography. Find us on thefutureofphotography.com. You can join our Discord. Link is in the show notes. We have a YouTube channel with these podcasts as videos. We have photos online if we talk about photos here at tftgf.com/tfopphotos. And hit us up, join the Discord, get in the discussion. And we'll be back, well, looks like next week. So until then, everyone, take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
You've been listening to The Future of Photography. Join the discussion on our Discord, find the show notes and all episodes at thefutureofphotography.com, and subscribe wherever you listen to audio.